Welcome, and we're going to start, as we do, with reading a psalm, Psalm 100. And as I do, why don't you stand, because we're going to go right into our worship time, singing to the Lord. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before Him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is He who made us, and we are His. We are His people, the sheep of His pasture. Enter His gates with thanksgiving and His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him and praise His name. For the Lord is good, and His love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. Amen. Amen.
May be seated. Our congregational prayer this morning comes from Luke 9:23-24. Then he said to them all, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me." Would you read verse 24 with me? "For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me will save it." Here's just some key words and ideas to pray through for the next 2 minutes silently in your seat. Be my disciple, take up your cross, die daily, follow Jesus, find life. Will you take the next 2 minutes just to pray silently in your seats, and then I'll close us with the word of prayer together. Mm-hmm. Father, Lord God, we just thank you for your grace and your mercy this morning, Lord. We thank you that you have called us to follow you. You called us to be your disciples, Lord. Help us to daily die to ourselves, to our wants and desires, our ambitions and plans, and to submit to you and truly find life and to follow Jesus all the days of our lives. Without death, there is no resurrection. Help us to die to ourselves and to find life in you and to follow you all the days of our lives. May our life echo that of Paul's. I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but it is Christ who lives within me. Lord, help us to follow you, to die daily, to live for your glory and the good of others, Lord. Not our will, but your will be done, Lord. So would you work that in our church, in our own hearts, in our own lives, Lord, that you may be glorified, that many would come to know you, and that we would live for your glory and honor. We ask all this in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fears is gone. Because I know. Thank you. because he lives.
Please be seated. I'm Pastor Craig, and I'd like to welcome you to the Union Church of Rio de Janeiro, now celebrating 136 years of serving the greater Rio area, serving the migrant populations of the world with English, kind of as a tool, an oasis, but being Bible-based, a Bible-based international church, and it's preaching of the gospel, the good news. It's knowing that he lives. That's what makes our life worth living, and that is the message that we've been proclaiming for these 136 years. Do you know that joy? Do you know that joy? Can I hear an amen, brother? Okay, we got Cheeto back there with two thumbs up. Do you know the joy of knowing Christ? And that's what Paul says, I consider all things lost, save the joy of Christ. It makes life worth living, even in the most difficult of times. Well, that's the message that we proclaim here at the Union Church. I want to welcome you all, and to those of you who are joining us live by Facebook, welcome. Or even those who will be joining us maybe even tomorrow on the posting of this worship service. We want to make sure that you feel connected by being here, and very welcome. We do have a few announcements before we continue our service. And we invite you to join us every Sunday morning at 9:02 with Professor Sam over here. We have a theology course that we offer, and you can actually find that online as well. That's part of our UC University. But it's an adult Bible study that meets here Sunday mornings right before this worship service, 9:02 we call it. And then also you can get that on Tuesday nights. It's posted, but if you go to Facebook and just type in Union Church Rio, you can look up UC University, and all our theological courses up to date are there. I want to also encourage you to tell others of our Facebook Live. That Sunday mornings you can join us live. Now again, to the church, as a pastor, I'm going to exhort you to come. This is a corporate worship day. And all the other days you worship at home by yourself, right? But this is one day of the week that we call you to come as a whole body to worship together. So I want to encourage you to not forsake the gathering of believers, as some are in the custom of doing, but to come to gather and to encourage one another to love and to good deeds, and all the more as we see the day of his return. Amen? Amen, brother?
Amen.
Okay, very good. And there's our UC University. That's what you'll see, and you can click on that. You'll see several topics there, what we believe. And also on Wednesdays, we are in the middle of our weekly a series called The Seven Deadly Sins. And we're going to be talking about that today. Murder. Wow. Heaven and hell. And not only on the visual stuff, the behavioral stuff, you can see what is transparent through not only our actions but our attitudes, but we're going deeper below the surface to the heart. What causes that rage and that anger, right? And what are your values? What do you believe about God, about yourself, about this world that causes you, that causes me to anger and beyond, all right? So I'm going to encourage you to look up that series, our weekly communion. That's going to be ongoing. We're going to present to you a tool and how you can use that tool with one another, just in your conversation, to help disciple one another in the Lord. If you are a first timer with us or a visitor here, we encourage you. I met Chip out there to fill out this card here, register your presence with us. And you can put that in the offering plate at the end of the service, or you can put that on the connections table in the back. I'll get that. We, the leadership team, and there's a number of things you can choose from as well, asking for prayer, even how to know God in a personal way. So I think that's all we have. Yeah, without further ado, let's stand up and continue to worship the Lord Jesus Christ in song.
Not your home.
love like this the world has never known. A crown of thorns to mark your name, forgiveness fell upon your face. A love like this the world. For grace, let her be no higher name, Jesus, Son of God. You lay down your perfect life, you are the sacrifice, Jesus, Son of God. You are Jesus, Son of God. You lay down your perfect life, you are the sacrifice, Jesus, Son of God. You are Jesus, Son of
God.
Please be seated. I want to thank again this group, Carrying On, Fiery Flarch. Pastor Rodrigo and Hosanna and Joachim are traveling this last 2 weeks. They'll be back next week. Well, let's just thank these guys once again. We're doing a great job. All these guys like you and me, they work, they're busy people, have their ministries, and yet every Sunday they're here very, very early and preparing during the week. So we're really, really grateful for our worship team, our tech team as well, the guys in the booth. Victor's helping us out there this morning, and Natasha, we can't see you, but we know you're there. Thank you, guys. It's cool. Today we are continuing our series Dynamic, a look at the book of Acts, and it's your family history, it's my family history. You know, when you personally make a decision through repentance and belief in the Lord Jesus Christ, you bow the knee and you say, I'm dead to self, but I live for Jesus. I've been crucified with Christ, but now Christ lives in me. That's the divine power. That is amazing. Pentecost, the pouring out of the Holy Spirit. Now it's not a come to see, but now a go and tell faith, where we're empowered by the Holy Spirit, that we are a priesthood of believers, and it's a pretty amazing deal that we have, and it's called Dynamic, this whole series, because of the dynamic life in Christ. Not only individually, once you make that decision, then you are grafted in to a new creation, a new temple. Each of you are a living stone in that, or the very body of Christ. And we've been seeing that Christ's death and resurrection was the very early part of the ministry. But his current ministry, he's seated at the right hand of God in power, and he works through his spiritual body, the church. And we're called to come together, each one with their different role, their different purpose, some being a hand and an arm, and some being a foot, and all different roles. But who is the head? Christ is our head. I want to share this photo with you. You can see it on the screen. Now, if that was huge, right? This is a photo I took of an old Victorian home. And tell me now if this light wasn't right here. It was a little darker. You were broke down on this street and there was nobody around. Would you go up to that porch and knock on the door for help? Some of you might just pray all the way here in the car, Lord, for help. I'm not going to go up there, right? There's something ominous about that picture. And what is it? Actually, it's a beautiful house right on the beach, you know, and you would probably be very blessed if you went there looking for help. I don't know. But what makes this shot so ominous is the contrast, right? The light and the dark, the shadows. Well, our text today is just like this photo. It is a series of contrasts of light and of darkness, of grace and of anger, of heaven and of hell. And so I would ask you to stand with me now as we read our text, Acts 7, verses 54 through chapter 8, 1. Just a few verses this morning, but really, really packed full. And if you carry that image of that kind of scary Victorian home with all its contrast, yeah, we're going to see both heaven and hell. And you can maybe, as we go through, begin to see some of that imagery in this true story, okay? This true story. This is part of our history, our family history, okay? So let's read together, starting Acts 7, verse 54. When the members of the Sanhedrin heard this, they were furious and gnashed their teeth at him. But Stephen, full of the Holy Spirit, looked up to heaven, saw the glory of God, and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. "Look," he said, "I see heaven open and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God." At this, they covered their ears, and yelling at the top of their voices, they all rushed at him, dragged him out of the city, and began to stone him. Meanwhile, the witnesses laid their coats at the feet of a young man named Saul. Now, while they were stoning him, Stephen prayed, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." Then he fell on his knees and cried out, "Lord, do not hold this sin against them." When he had said this, he fell asleep. And Saul approved of their killing him. Would you pray with me? Lord, we come before you today. Would you show us some of those contrasts? Would you show us the grace? Would you show us, oh Lord, the anger? Would you reveal in us those things, oh Lord? Would you show us heaven? Would you show us hell, oh Lord, that we might be repentant every day of our lives and that we might draw close to you in faith and belief? Father, would you transform us into the image of Christ, that we might walk a little bit more like Stephen than certainly the rest of the world, O Lord Jesus, that we might be more like his model to us, so that we might, O Lord, one day be received by you in the way that Stephen was. Give us that peace, give us that joy, give us that confidence in your word, O Lord Jesus. We pray this. Amen. Please be seated. Well, what is the context of this horrific scene before us? Do you remember? Stephen, he's a man characterized by what? He's a man that is filled with the Holy Spirit. He is filled with faith and power and grace and another thing, wisdom, okay? We see him as a servant, serving or administrating the needs of the widows. And we're not talking a few widows at the luncheon, but hundreds of needy people. We see him as just a marvelous preacher, preaching the word of God in power with conviction. We see him as a miracle maker, one who has done many wonders before the people. And so he is known by everyone in his community. How? as a good guy, one of the best, as a man of faith and a person of good works. And yet today we find this good guy under trial. It doesn't make sense. Well, we know that the Sanhedrin, or the Jewish Supreme Court, there were 70 of these guys, plus a mob, plus the false witnesses, right? They ask him of all these charges. Stephen, is it true? Are you a blasphemer of Moses? Are you a blasphemer of God? Of this holy place, the temple, and of the law? Well, we know the answer, right? Because we just said what kind of guy this is. He is at peace. And they see him with the face of an angel because he's confident. And he stands clean before the Lord. He is not guilty of blasphemy of these things. He is authentic inwardly. His desires and his values and his beliefs are congruent with everything he does and says on the outside. His servanthood, his miracles, his preaching. He is sincere and he is radiant before them in peace, right? But he points out to them, his accusers, that indeed it's not him who's committed blasphemy, but it's them who's committed blasphemy against the land, against Moses, against the temple, truly against God. In fact, Stephen believes all these things were given by God and they're so important in the Old Testament and the law of Moses, right? These are critical for salvation. And yet what he realizes is these are not an end to themselves, but they're a foreshadowing of what God was about to do. They all pointed to a greater glory. As great of glory as we have in all that, God wants to do something even greater. And this points us to him. And that is through his Son. That is through the Messiah. That is through the Eternal One. The administration of David, the dynasty that would never end. And yet, what he realizes is that these Jewish leaders have committed idolatry, holding so fast to those physical objects and things, worshiping the Creator, they've lost sight of the Creator, worshiping the Created, they've lost sight of the Creator and what he plans to do. And he was even pointing out how much greater the tabernacle is than the temple. Because at least the temple, you had to follow God daily. But now in your stone hearts, you stay here in this temple. God has departed. He's doing something greater. His glory has come and you've rejected it. And we see in Acts 7, 51 through 53, he says, "You stiff-necked people, your hearts and ears are still uncircumcised. You are just like your ancestors." And he's talking about unbelief. "You always resist the Holy Spirit. Was there ever a prophet your ancestors did not persecute? They even killed those who predicted the coming of the Righteous One." And that is the Messiah, that is Jesus. "And now you have betrayed and murdered him. You who have received the law that was given through angels, but have not obeyed it." So here's the big picture. Unfortunately, God's grace did not move them. The glory of the gospel did not transform them. They did not have ears to hear. They did not have eyes to see. They were blind. And God's judgment now infuriates them. John MacArthur points out four contrasts between the accused and the accuser, between Stephen and the Sanhedrin, between heaven and hell. I named this sermon Heaven and Hell because of these contrasts. I'm going to walk you through three of those this morning, okay? And the very first one is this, that they, the Sanhedrin, the Supreme Court, was full of rage and anger. And Stephen was filled with the Holy Spirit. Acts 7, 55 54 through 55. Now, if you have your Bible, I encourage you at this point, open up that Bible, look in the bulletin. It's also printed there. You might have your physical Bible or your digital Bible at home. You can pause and open those things up. But very important to follow along. Acts 7, 54 through 55. When the members of the Sanhedrin heard this, they were furious and gnashed their teeth at him. But Stephen, full of the Holy Spirit. Well, this kind of fury demonstrates what? That they lose control, right? This is the contrast of one being out of control and one being controlled by the Holy Spirit, the fruits of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, and even patience. Well, Psalm 35:16 says this, like godless gestures at a feast, they gnashed at me with their teeth. And Psalm 37:12 says this, the wicked plots against the righteous and gnash at them with their teeth. There's this anger that contorts the body. Question. What else do the scriptures teach us about gnashing of teeth? And where does that happen? Very important here. Luke 13:28. Taking notes, write this one down. Then Jesus went through the towns and villages, teaching as he made his way to Jerusalem. And someone asked him, Lord, are only a few people going to be saved? And he said to them, make every effort to enter through the narrow door. And that's him. Because many, I tell you, will try to enter and will not be able to. Once the owner of the house gets up and closes the door, you will stand outside, you will knock and plead, sir, open the door for us. But he will answer, I don't know you or where you come from. But then you'll say, but we ate and drank with you and you taught on our streets. But he will reply, I don't know you or where you come from. Away from me, all you evildoers. And there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth when you see Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and all the prophets in the kingdom of God, but you yourselves thrown out. People will come from the east and from the west and the north and the south and will take their places in the feast of the kingdom of God. Indeed, there are those who are last who will be first and the first who will be last. And we see in Matthew 8, Matthew 13, Matthew 22, Matthew 24, these are all places where Jesus talks about hell. And he says there that there will be weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth. Fury, anger, rage are characterized by gnashing of teeth towards God and towards his righteous ones. And one of the things that John MacArthur points out I found very interesting is this. Hell does not produce remorse. It produces anger. It produces fury. He goes on to say that hell is full of people in a furious rage, furious because they are there, furious because of the influences they followed, furious because of the decisions they made, and furious at the one that consigned them there. These people are outraged. And they are forever outraged. They are gnashing their teeth at this moment in fury against the gospel preacher Stephen. And they are still gnashing their teeth in the 21st century at those who uphold the word of God and preach the gospel. So ironic, isn't it? Stephen is being falsely accused. He's being murdered. He has every right to lash about desperately like an animal, pleading for help. Save me. Remember the thief who hung by Jesus, and he hurled out insults. And he hurled out insults about Jesus. Stephen, if anybody, had a right at that time to hurl out insults to, like a beast, like a you see on these channels, you know, they growl and they grind their teeth. It's angry, it's fury. And yet he's composed with the face of an angel, at peace before God and his ancestors. Question for you this morning, brother, sister. What has control over you? Is it rage, anger, fury? What sets you off? Or are you controlled by the Holy Spirit? Love, joy, peace, patience, even when you are wronged, even when you are overlooked, not promoted. Accused, falsely accused. Well, the second contrast that we see is that they were spiritually blind. The Sanhedrin, they had the robes and they had the power, they had the authority, but they were spiritually blind while Stephen had heavenly vision. They were hard-hearted, they were stiff-necked, they were uncircumcised spiritually. Unable to obey. They were willfully blind, but now judicially so. In a rage and anger, they're going to throw out all the process of the law and judgment. Romans quotes Isaiah 6, seeing then, but they couldn't see, hearing, but they couldn't hear, receiving, but they couldn't understand, they could not perceive, they couldn't repent, they couldn't be saved. Acts 7, 57 and 58, verses 57 and 58 of our text. At this, they covered their ears and yelling, ah, at the top of their voices, a screech that just involuntarily comes out. They rushed at him and they drag him out of the city and begin to stone him. Can you imagine all these 70 in their robes and the mob rushing forward? What an ominous sight. Again, MacArthur points out this word rush. Very interesting. Remember in Mark 5 when Jesus casts out the legion from the man? Where did they go? Into pigs, thousands of pigs. And what did the pigs do? They rushed over the cliff and into the water and were killed. It's the same word. They rushed at him like animals raving. It's the same word in Ephesus where in Acts 19, the mob rushes at Paul and wants him dead. They didn't want to follow rules. They just wanted to stamp out his life. But here again, we see Stephen full of the Holy Spirit. And another benefit of the Holy Spirit, while they are full of rage, Stephen, he sees clearly. He has this heavenly vision. Even heaven opening up to him while the Sanhedrin rushes in this black blindness. Acts 7, 55 and 56. But Stephen, full of the Holy Spirit, looked up to heaven. And he saw what? It's like these lights, the glory of God. And Jesus standing at the right hand of God. Look, he said, I see heaven open and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. Here's a point. Stephen identifies him as who? The Son of Man. This is an Old Testament term used by Daniel. And it's a term, the Son of Man, that Jesus used about himself more than any other term, the Son of Man. So it's an Old Testament term from the prophets that identify the Messiah. And it's the term that the Sanhedrin knew that Jesus used for himself. And here, Stephen is testifying that the heavens open up, just like at Jesus' baptism, right? And Jesus, the Messiah, is standing at the right hand of God. Now, this is also interesting because normally when we read that Jesus is at the right hand of God, he is what? He is seated at the right hand of God and seated on the throne. He's the ruler. He's before all things. He is the creator over all things. And we said that verse, right? Colossians 1, 15 through 17. This is why it's good to memorize. We may not have these visions of heaven or the third heaven, right? But we have visions of Christ written for us. The Son of God is the image of the invisible God. He is the firstborn over all creation. For in him all things were created, visible and invisible. Jesus created it. Whether they be thrones or whether they be powers or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him, for his glory. He is before all things, and all things are held together by him. So he is not only the creator from long time ago, but all things have been created. They are continually created by him, and they're held together by him. He's the sustainer of all things. What things? All things, whether thrones or powers, rulers or authorities, Jesus is over them all. This is why we need to see what Stephen saw. It's a touch of heaven on earth. Because what we see is scary. We see Lula, and we see Bolsonaro, right? And everybody's fighting and gnashing their teeth and raging because they're scared, right? But what does Stephen see? He sees Christ, the image of the invisible God. And we go on to read that passage. He is not only the head of the church, but God in his glory was pleased by setting his fullness in him and reconciled all things to himself through the Christ. Things in heaven and things on earth. What does that even mean? But Christ reconciles them all. He's our creator, our sustainer, and the reconciler. And here he's no longer seated, but he's gotten up. The first martyr of the church is about to be killed, and Jesus gets up. Now, I don't know if you've ever been to a graduation, a doctoral graduation, but all the professors who have a doctoral degree in their colors, they stand. Different than the other graduates. And as the doctoral, the one who has just been graduated, you know, formação, they all stand and they welcome him with honor. So Jesus, who rules, now he stands and he welcomes Stephen with honor. He gets up. Faithful in life, faithful in death. And the one who created, the one who sustains, the one who reconciles, he is there. He is the faithful witness, and he is saying, welcome. Jesus standing to honor and crown Stephen as he enters into God's presence. To be absent from the body is to be what? Presence with the Lord. And this is a blessing that we see. This is the peace that Stephen has awarded. And when we hear testimony of many martyrs, and Sam shared us that horrific story, he wasn't killed, but it would have been easier for him to be killed of what he went through. But again, he never cursed his accusers, but he prayed for them. And Stephen is blessed in the hour of his greatest trial. He sees what few humans have seen. And I'm going to read this because this is just too good to pass up. Again, MacArthur points this out. I wouldn't have seen this. I apologize, but it's good stuff. He says this, incredibly, he saw the glory of God. He saw the Shekinah, right? Which few humans have seen. He saw what Adam and Eve saw in the garden when they walked and talked with God in the cool of the eve. He saw what Isaiah saw in the vision of chapter 6. And if you don't know that, go back and see Isaiah's vision of chapter 6 of that book, Isaiah. The Lord lifted high, lifted upon the throne. He saw what Ezekiel saw in chapter 1. He saw what the Apostle Paul saw when he was caught up into the third heaven. He saw what Moses saw when he was taken up to Mount Sinai and beheld the glory of the Lord, and the Lord passed before him. He saw what the Apostle John saw in the visions on Patmos as he wrote the book of Revelation. He saw what Peter, James, and John saw on the Mount of Transfiguration. He saw a vision of the glory of God. Incredibly encouraging, incredibly wondrous and hopeful. But not only the glory of God, but he saw Jesus standing ready to welcome him into that light. Stephen saw the light, and Stephen saw standing at the right-hand side of the light. Jesus in his glorified sense. This morning I want to ask you, church, brother and sister in the Lord, what do you see? In the midst of a change, an ever-changing world, in the midst of chaos, confusion, are you looking down, gnashing your teeth, angry? Earthly things that created? Or are you looking up towards heaven? Do you have a clear image of the ascended Christ and who he is? Well, the third contrast I'd like to share with you is that the Sanhedrin, was filled with judgment and wrath. But Stephen was filled with grace and forgiveness. Acts 7:57 through 8:1. At this they covered their ears, and yelling at the top of their voices, they all rushed and dragged him out of the city and began to stone him. Meanwhile, the witnesses laid their coats at the feet of the young man Saul. Now we saw that, but listen. While they were stoning him, Stephen prayed. In the midst of this, Stephen prayed to the one he could see. And he said, Lord, receive my spirit. And then he fell on his knees and he cried out, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. And when he had said this, he fell asleep. When Christians die, they fall asleep. And this is a lesson to know. We sleep. And the Spirit goes to be with the Lord. And we see that here in Acts. We see it in 2 Corinthians 5, 6 through 9. If you need courage today, your spirit goes to be with the Lord immediately. Philippians 1, 23. Hebrews 12, 22 through 23. And when Jesus returns on the day, he will bring with him the spirits of those who sleep. And their bodies who are raised to glory. And the spirit and the body will be together again for eternity, forever with the Lord. Body and spirit united in glory forever with Jesus. Well, the Sanhedrin has blood on its hands. They killed the Messiah. And they now have killed this good man, full of faith, full of wisdom, full of grace, And the scriptures teach that in AD 70, the Lord God brings judgment on those, that Jewish leadership. And all who were still living were killed in the invasion of the Romans. That this was vengeance from God. But interesting, Stephen didn't take that upon himself. Stephen prayed for them. Vengeance of the Lord. He was testifying to life, the good news. He is full of grace. And Stephen was not only tried in a manner similar to that of our Lord, right? He had the false witnesses, went through many of the same things that Jesus did. But he also died with a similar prayer on his lips. We see that in Jesus' life in Luke 23, 34. Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. Warren Wiersbe shares a story where a heckler once shouted to a street preacher, one of these guys preaching on the street, you know. And he heckled and he said, you know, what did God ever do for Stephen? He did nothing. And the street preacher said, oh, but he did. He gave Stephen the grace to forgive and to pray for his accusers. And what fruit do we have from that? The greatest evangelist of all time, right? It was the young Saul that was there who was giving approval. It was the young Saul where they took their coats off so they could get a better throw of the rock. And it's the same Saul that later that Jesus the Lord met. And he was prepared because of Stephen's preaching, right? In the glory of Jesus, and he knew, fulfilling what he'd heard from Stephen. And Saul, the Lord says to Saul, you need to see all that you must suffer for my glory. And it's that same Saul that becomes Paul, the apostle, taking the gospel to the nations, counting all but loss, all that religious stuff that he had gained by his own knowledge, by his race, being born in the right family, following all the right things, he counts but loss, rubbish, for the glory of knowing Christ. And he too would face a martyr's end. Question, what do you desire today, church? What do you desire? Is it heaven or is it hell? Do you want to be like Stephen, filled with the Spirit? Heaven. Or controlled by anger, self-righteousness, hell. You want to be like Stephen with a clear vision of Christ, the creator, the sustainer, and the redeemer. Or you want to be blind spiritually, enslaved to idolatry, worshiping the created rather than the creator himself, a life-changing experience with God. You want to be like Stephen, full of grace and forgiving those who wrong you. Heaven. Non-judgmental and controlled by vengeance and wrath. Hell. Well, it begins with two words. Repentance and belief. Repentance is just a way to die daily. Confess. I sin. I blew it. Forgive me, Lord. Help me to die to the desires of my heart that promote me and mine. And I turn to you, O Lord. I am crucified. Live in me, Christ, through the power of your Spirit. I had an opportunity this week. I got some news, and I admit, I just, in rage, I was provoked, and I said, as the pastor, I'm going to do this. Boom. Just informing you, my title, my authority, I will do it. And then a brother just called me by the side, put his arm around me, and said, well, you have the authority, and you might want to do that. Would you consider this? I'll consider that. And And I simply took some time and wrote out what I was planning to do, and it took me 2 hours to kind of say what I was planning to do, you know. And in that time, I realized, wait a minute, why am I gnashing my teeth and reacting in anger, you know? And I said, Lord, I want to be controlled by the Spirit. And so just sharing with some brothers who love me and listening to their wisdom, yeah, we came up with a plan together that will honor the Lord. Hopefully impact the church in a positive way. Warren Wiersbe shares a journal entry from Jim Elliot. Many of you know Jim Elliot was about 26 years old when he was on a missions trip, taking the gospel to the Auca Indians. I think it was Ecuador. And in this entry, his journal entry, Jim Elliot, he said a lot of good things for a young man, but he said this: Lord, I seek not a long life, but a full one like you. And 2 years later, he wrote, I must not think it strange if God takes in youth, those whom I would have kept on earth till they were older. God is simply peopling eternity, and I must not restrict him to old men and old women. He wants some young ones. Well, like Stephen, Jim Elliot, he and his comrades were called to people eternity. They were martyred by the ones they were sharing the gospel with. They were killed. And Wiersbe goes on to say, what has happened to the Aucas since then is proof that the blood of the martyrs is indeed the seed of the church. Today, many Aucas are now Christians. Beautiful story. Oh, Jim Elliot's wife goes back to the crowd, to the tribes that killed her very husband. And through her life and testimony, they come to know Jesus. We're going to have our third prayer vigil, 24 hours of prayer. And Sam and I are putting this together. We brainstorm. He gets it all done while I'm jibber-jabbering. He's like, you mean like this? So we have 24 stories of persecuted Christians, kind of their context, and Bible verses, and then prayers. And so amongst other prayers, this time we're going to be guided by the persecuted church based on not only the scriptures of today, the testimony of Stephen, Jim Elliot, and we have here a number of people that are suffering today in many countries going on today. And so that's going to be August, I think it's 26, 27, Friday and Saturday, 24 hours, starting at 6 p.m. Friday to 6 p.m. Saturday. But this time it's exciting because though we'll be in our homes praying and we'll have the virtual thing set up, the last 4 hours we're going to be here for those who want to come. And we'll have our band here. And they'll be playing worship music, and we'll have corporate time for prayer, and you'll have times as well to conclude that time here together. In conclusion, the heart of man has not changed since those days. Humanity is not evolving into better people. The heart of man has not changed, nor can be changed apart from the grace of God. Luke 9:23 through 27. We read it earlier. We prayed it. Then he said to them all, Jesus said to them all, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves, take up their cross daily and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it. But whoever loses their life for me will save it. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world and yet to lose or forfeit their very soul, their self? Whoever is ashamed of me and my words, the Son of Man will be ashamed of them when he comes in his glory and in the glory of the Father and of the holy angels. You know, God doesn't call us all to be martyrs. Thank goodness for that, right? But he calls us all to be living sacrifices. And sometimes it's harder to live as a living sacrifice for Christ, to die daily for a lifetime, which we're called to do, than to die once for Christ. But this is the promise of Scripture. If you live as a living sacrifice, dead to self, alive to Christ, if you are called to one day lay down your life as a seed for the church to grow, you will be prepared. And in the same way that Stephen was blessed, in the same way the testimony of all the martyrs, we see that they are blessed with a second and third and fourth measure of the presence of the Holy Spirit. Let's pray. Lord, we want to give you thanks for giving us a glimpse of Jesus. Not only the crucified Christ, not only the resurrected Christ, but the Christ that is seated by the right hand of your glory, the ruler Christ, and the one that gets up to receive his own, O Lord. Help us to look up and see you, O Lord, in eternity. Help us turn from our rage and clenched teeth and looking down. Father, we repent, we confess that so often we grasp the created and the created order and the world, the principles of this world, instead of dying to self and letting Christ live in us. Would you start today by doing that in me and in us? We pray this in Jesus' name for your glory and our good. Amen. Well, we're going to conclude our time with our tithes and offerings. And you can just stay where you are. We're going to pass an offering plate as we sing a song. Now, if you're a visitor here today, this is not over obligation to give, but for our regular attenders and our regular members, our members, we know as we study the scriptures, the blessing it is to give. Proverbs 11, 24 and 25 says this, "Now there is one who is free in giving, and yet he grows richer. And there is one who keeps what he should give, but he ends up needing more. The man who gives much will have much, and the one who helps others will be helped himself." This is a gospel principle. It's truly a mystery, but it falls in line with the sermon that we just saw. That we don't look down and clench and hold on to what we have, but in a spiritual and even physical way, when we die to selves and even give of our first fruits, we are blessed beyond measure. God in various ways gives, and what he offers, there rust and moth and salt water, right, can't destroy. Let's stand as we sing and worship the Lord in our tithes and our offerings. Wanna thank you, Lord.
You took my sickness and healed all my pain. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
With a grateful heart.
With a grateful heart. With a song of praise. With an ostrich charm. I'll bless your name. Thank you, Lord. I just wanna thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just wanna thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Say it again.
Thank you, Lord. I just wanna thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. I just wanna thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Na, 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 na.
Thank you, Lord. Amen. Yeah. I tell you what, many, many things can be happening that are confusing and wrong and difficult. And in the end, it does matter to our day-to-day life who wins the election, right? It will impact us. But on another sense, if our eyes are fixed to heaven, if you really desire what God wants, if you really believe what God teaches, it doesn't really matter in the end, because you can fulfill what God's called you to do. So when this service is over, if some of that's confusing to you, where did I even start with that? Because that has to do with desire, and it has to do with worldview. It starts with repentance and belief. I would just ask you to come forward, and I can help you out with that, pray with you. And those are tough decisions to make. Okay? Let us give thanks for all that the Lord has given us. Father, again, we thank you for what you provide for us. We thank you for the first fruits. We thank you that even in the midst of tough times, O Lord, you do provide. Lord, now will you use these tithes and these offerings for your glory, that this word, that this hope in life, in death, would go out to a needy world, to a dark world, to a blind world, to an angry world, O Lord. Would the power of your grace through your local church be sent through these funds, Lord. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. As the ushers go, I also want to invite you for a time of refreshment. Today we're going to have that right outside here.
Yes, the tables are on the grass.
Okay, on the grass. We have some ongoing works while the school is on vacation. So if you run out this way, you may miss it because you'll go right into the fellowship hall and there'll be nothing, friends. But if you go out this way, yeah, you'll find some really delicious snacks and invite you to hang out and get connected. Now, may we send you out with the Lord's blessing through the benediction. Let us go forth into the world in peace and dedicated to the Lord's service. Let us hold fast to that which is good and true. Render to no person evil for evil. Strengthen those who are faint-hearted, supporting the weak, helping the needy and the afflicted, and honoring others above ourselves. Let us love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of His Spirit and in grace. And may God's blessing be upon us and remain always with us while we do His will. Go, church. Go in the blessing of the Lord. Go in peace.
With a grateful heart, with a song of praise, with an ostrich heart, I'll bless your name. Thank you, Lord. I just wanna thank you.